Hiya people! Today in the D&D basement we're gonna show you how to make an adventure in about an hour or so from making the maps to making the adventure. And we'll see how it goes. So here we are on our desktop, ready to paint our first dungeon, random dungeon. So here I got Photoshop opened with the 11 width by 8.5 inch picture, which basically our map will fit on a single sheet of paper for those who wants to print it. Now I got my grid, like I already showed you before, and it's all set up to go. So let's open our Dungeon Master's Guide here on page 99. In that PDF, usually it's really page 99. So here on page 99, we got our adventure environment. The first thing we want to do for our campaign is to when we create a dungeon and something like that, when you don't know where you want to go, so what we'll do here is create ourselves an adventure, and we'll start with a dungeon. And for that, we need to know where that dungeon is gonna be. We need to know its purpose, and we need to know who, its history, who was there before everything that happens here, and why is it here now. Basically, basic stories. You'll see these tables are awesome for that. I'm also gonna use a random dice generator so you can see everything I do. Okay, let's start by our dungeon location, because we need to know firsthand where it is gonna be. So it requires us to roll a d100. It's a percentage dice, so we'll go with one. So let's roll our percentage. We got 32. So let's see where that goes on. 32. It's in a chasm. So basically what we'll do is we're gonna create some text just to write that down. Random. Alright, so its location is gonna be in a chasm. So for that should help you to actually create some mood, maybe create some environments if you didn't know where to go for that, from that. So the next part of it is to know of its creators. Who created the dungeon? So it requires a d20, so let's roll a d20. D20, roll, we got an 8. So we got an 8. And 8 is dwarves. Classic. So creator is dwarf. Dwarves. Once you know that, depending on what you get, you could have cults and religious groups actually do it, and there's a table for that. There's an NPC alignment, so if you get onto humans here, you have the NPC alignments here. For them, the classes under here. But for now, we know it's a chasm, and it's in a chasm, and it's created by dwarves. So that already tells us a lot about it. Now, we need a dungeon purpose. Why is that was that dungeon built? Why did those dwarves build it? So, let's roll a d20. Here's our few purposes. There's Death Trap, Lair, Maze, Mine, Planar Gate, Stronghold, Temple, or Shrine, Tomb, and Treasure Vault. All good reasons to build a dungeon. So let's roll out d20. And we got a 2. 2 to 5 is a lair. So basically it's a lair. Alright. So our purpose is a lair. A lair can be everything you can go. You know, taking Batman as an example, Batman has the Batcave. The Batcave is his lair. So it could be a dwarf city, it could be a dwarf a settlement, because temporary settlement, it could have been a new construction site for fortress, could have been whatever you want. That's a lair. A lair is a place where you can live in. You actually live in. So that's about it. Here, just reading the example here, they actually say it's a place where monsters lived, but it could be everything. Seriously. Do not just check on here, but it's a good place to think. So, right now, this dungeon is a lair, so seeing here, we know it was created by dwarves, probably for a monster or their god or whatever. Could have been whatever, but for now, it's going to be for monsters. So the next thing we want to know, now that we know that, is know its history, the dungeon history. Why is it important to know the history of your dungeon? Because it actually adds up to everything you've done. Everything you do will have its place here. So let's get a dungeon history. It's asked us to roll a d20. So we're going to roll a d20 again. Wow, I really suck with my numbers. We got a 3. So, 3 it is. It was abandoned by its creators. Doesn't say why. Maybe you'll have to figure that out yourself. So, basically, its history. It was abandoned by its creators. So, we know whatever dwarves decided to create that lair, he's not there anymore. He's gone. Maybe he's coming back later for another adventure. But for now, he's gone. So let's continue. Now that we have these, we need the dungeon inhabitants. The actual, what's in it now, in the present. So let's get going for the present. So it could be everything, it could be factions, it could be it has an ecology, it has everything you actually need. Alright, now that we have everything for the history and the likes, we're going to go back into the book, and we're going to go back a chapter. Instead of chapter 3 for where we're going to chapter 2. I really don't like how they build their chapters. They create NPCs before everything else, and they even create the goals of the dungeons before knowing the history of the dungeon. Oh, I'm a bit lost on that one. Took me time to find it out, but here we go. So, the next thing we're gonna do is what we want now for our adventure. What's happening now? So, the first thing we're gonna do is do a dungeon goals. Why our characters are there? What's the reason for them to be there? So we have the wilderness here, or the dungeon goals here. By the way, I'm on page 73 of the Dungeon Master's Guide of the fifth edition. So let's roll a d20 and see what will be the goal of our characters. Oh God, I got another low roll, 10. That's an average roll. Well, we got a 10. So with 10, basically the goal that we get is find an NPC who disappeared in the area. So let's add that. So the goal is find an NPC who disappeared in the area. So our characters basically are there to rescue somebody. If you want some other goals for it, you can. There's a lot of places for the need here. We're gonna create another goal. So I'm gonna roll a d12 this time. So I'm gonna roll a d12, and I get a 6. And with a 6, oh god, does that fit well? So, as another goal, our players will have to break a prisoner out of the jail. So, basically they'll meet somebody in down there. So, I'm gonna call this a sub-goal. And break a prisoner out of the jail. Or prison camp, or whatever. So we'll see, maybe it's the character they were there to rescue that actually gets the... tell them that one, there were two of them, and the second one has been captured and brought elsewhere, so it leads to another adventure. Or it could be, my friend is in another room, so break him out. And that's gonna be it. So, for now, this is gonna be the goal. So, the reason why we're going there is that. Now, what's gonna be the villains? Who's inhabiting that dungeon? We need to know. Otherwise, the adventure doesn't happen. So, let's figure out a villain. Adventure villains, take a d20. So, rolling a d20 again. Got a 16. It's a humanoid criminal mastermind. Oh wow. So we got a humanoid with the big badass ego. So our villain is a humanoid criminal mastermind. All these info will make the dungeon, the adventure, actually happen. I'm not gonna put any ally into this one, but if you wanted the adventure, your characters to meet some allies, you could right here on these tables. So for now, that's gonna be it. Now we need a patron. Who sent the characters over there? As you can see, it requires a d20, and there's a lot about it that can happen. Including number 20, which is the villain himself, bringing the characters there for whatever reason he needs. So let's roll a d20 and we'll be set. So I got an 8. So with 8, it's a temple official. Basically, we've got hired by a temple official. So our patron is... no, not a humanoid criminal mastermind. No, really not. It's gonna be a temple patron. Once you have that out, they tell you to actually flesh out the location details, finish out your history of your dungeon at this point. For now, we'll simply say that the old dwarves had a monster as a kind of god to them, and they created that dungeon for that monster. But all of this has been long gone since then. All of this has been long gone, whatever the reason is. Now, find the ideal introduction. I'm not gonna enter into that. I prefer to leave that to your DM, to the DM, to yourself. Right now, if you're not really sure what introduction, kind of introduction you can get, there's a few here that actually tells you what. It's rolling a d12, and there's a lot. Like here, 12, ghost appears and terrorizes the village. Research reveals that it can be put to rest only by entering the adventure location. So basically, the characters were told there was a ghost by the patron that there was a ghost in town, and once they finally speak to the ghost, they've been told that what he needs is in that place. And it's gonna be, since our goal was to actually rescue someone, so it's a person. It has to be a person. Rescue him and I'll stop terrorizing everything. See, that actually can be everything, but those are just IDs. An NPC the character care about needs them to go to the adventure location. This means that the person that we have to rescue, that we go there, could be the sibling of one of your players. Now, the adventure introduction is all up to you, so go for it. Now, we need an adventure climax, the end of our adventure. So, here it requires us to roll a d12. Again, this could be left alone for you to know, and it will be for now. But that's something that you really can look about. Like, the adventurers come from the main villain and a group of minions in a bloody battle to the finish. So, basically, the classic, you enter the room, the villain has enough of you, so he and his minions just rush to you and wants to kill you. The adventurers chase the villain while dodging obstacles designed to thwart them, leading to a final confrontation in or outside the villain's refuge. So basically, the villain tries to escape, and you actually chase him out. And once he's out, the fight breaks out between you and I. You and it. It could be whatever you want, actually, but these are great if you're not totally sure. Basically, these guides gives you a start, a middle, and an end to your adventure. And it helps a lot to create into creating something. If you want some event-based, there's a few tables here. Event-based goals are here. But for now, we're not using these. The rest is pretty much everything else for event-based, if you want to frame somebody. Complications can be something as well, if you want to put a twist on your story. But for now, we're not using any of these. The side quest can be something else. Don't see it as another. Don't see it as another goal, as a sub goal, like we did in the beginning. See this as side quest, really side quest, quest that generates another adventure in another location. And people in your group can or cannot do these. Now we're creating encounters and the likes here. I'm gonna pass through that because I don't want to. For the sake of this, we know that it's a criminal mastermind, so we'll have to deal with bandits. Now here it explains how to create your encounters. But we do not want that. What we want is the creating non-player characters. So now we have our non-player characters. And we need two of them. We need the actual criminal mastermind, which is going to be our bandit chief. And we need our patron, the people who actually want us to be there. So, unless it could be in a temple and the patron doesn't matter, but here, for now, we're not going to use a temple patron. We know it's a temple, pray people, so basically find a way to get your adventurers to the temple and get them from there. So, we're not going to do that, but we'll need a villain, and that villain we'll need an NPC for. So, we'll create an NPC for it. It has a few things. You need an occupation and history, you need his appearance, abilities, talent, mannerism, interaction with others, useful knowledge, ideal bond, and flaw or secret. All of these determines an NPC story. So, for now, let's go for occupation and history. Occupation and history, he is a criminal mastermind, so let's not delve into that. His appearance, though, you can look at that, create some appearance, and I'm not going to do that right now. Honestly, I'm not going to create that NPC. I'm just showing you that you can actually create everything from scratch by just looking at the books, and it's going to be real fast. So, like, it could have distinctive jewelry, earrings, necklace, circlet, bracers, piercing, flamboyant, outlandish clothes, formal clothes, a ragged cloak, pronounced a scar, missing teeth, missing fingers, tattoos, birthmark, whatever you want. As long as it distinguishes the villain, the main villain, from the rest of the groups. His abilities, they suggest to you that you can, if you don't know what he's gonna be, cleric, barbarian, or whatever, you can take it here. Or you could simply take it up below, where we were creating our history. Now, you could have talents as well, you just play one in that one. Mannerism is something to actually make the NPC worth it. So all of these can be used for whatever you want as an NPC. For now, it would be our villains, but we could use it as well for NPCs in a city. Ooh, I love the builder. Now, from that point on, we know everything we need. Now, we know why, we want to know why our villain does what he wants. What's his motivations to do stuff? So, right here, we got the villain schemes table. So we want to know what our villain wants. So, let's do that. For now, it requires us a D8. And then it's gonna require us D4 or D6, depending on whatever it is. So right now we're gonna go with a D8, and we rolled a 7. So let's go back to our table and let's go for 7. Oh, our villain is set on revenge. So in the villain, I'm gonna put something like this. Motivation, like motives, is revenge. But now, what kind of revenge it is? Why does he seek revenge? This will help us create our story. So we require to roll for D4. So let's go for a D4, and we rolled a 2. So it's a 2. So avenge a past imprisonment or injury. I like the imprisonment. So basically, he's an escapee. He escaped prison, and he wants to avenge those who put him there. Maybe the person we're rescuing actually is somebody that got him there. So the motives is revenge. And now, we know why. So I'm going to put why, and it's going to be avenge a past imprisonment or injury. Now, we need some villain methods for all of this. You can know that as you roll, you're not forced to choose any of these. If it doesn't fit your story, you can actually just say change it for something else. Now, why our villain do this, his methods to do things, as I said, if nothing's worked, just re-roll and do whatever you want, or pick one in itself. For now, we're not gonna use these. We have the basics. We already have the basics. We have his motives, the why he does that. We got, it's a temple patron that told us about all of this, probably because they were responsible for his imprisonment. And we got everything we need here. So you can have a villain weakness if you want. It could be an object holds the villain's soul, the villain's power is broken, if the death of its true love is avenged, the villain is weakened in the presence of a particular artifact. We're not gonna use these right now, but it's there if you want. Now, you got some death domain for cleric and oathbreaker paladins, if you want. There's other classes in the dungeon guide. Now that we have everything, And I mean everything. Story-wise, we have the story, we have the adventure location, we have everything we need. Doing a campaign would be as easy as just repeating these steps all over again for multiple multiple dungeons, multiple places, and everything like that. But for now, we're done. So once we're done, we get to the interesting part. We have to actually create a random dungeon that will be all about this. So let's first start with the starting area. So here we are with the starting area. It asks us to roll a d10. So again, I have my Photoshop ready with my grid that I placed. If you want to know how to do this in Photoshop, look at my other videos in the map making playlist. So I got this here. I got my dice roller and I got my Dungeon Master's Guide on page 290, where we're gonna start with the starting area. So let's roll a d10 and see for ourselves what do we get. So we get a 9. So a 9 is a passage with a T intersection, and it's 10 feet wide. So let's start with this. We're gonna create our passage. So I'm gonna use the rectangle tool to create this. Each big square is 4 squares, 20 feet. And each little square is 5 feet. It's not necessary to use the grid as it should be. You can play gridless. These are just measurements for your dungeon, for actual scaling of your dungeon. It could be 1 square equal 10 feet if you want. But for now, we're going to use what we want. So we're going to start. And it says that it's a 10 feet wide corridor with a T intersection. We're going to make it, since it's the beginning, we're going to make it really long, since it's the beginning of the place. And as you can see, I started it up there. Now I just want that white. And I'll create some... I'll create some stroke for the walls. And one's gonna be not enough, so it's gonna be 2. So here we are. And it says it's a T, so we cannot start there. I really wish we could, but we can't. So we're gonna start it here in the middle, since it's a T. And now we're gonna create our junction. So, right here, right there, we got our junction. Now for the next room, now we go for the next room. Each entry point, the way you do this is each entry point leads to something. It could be another passageways, it could be a door, it could be whatever. So right now, what this guy told us with 9 is that it's a passage 10 feet wide with a T intersection. So, from that point on, we got 2 more exits. Now, what do we want to those exits? Do we want passages or rooms? I hate real long passages. Really, really long passages? No way. I don't like these. So, what we're gonna do here... What we're gonna do here... We're gonna go directly to a chamber. So here we have a chamber. So it requires us to roll a d20 to know what kind of chamber we get. So let's roll a d20 and we got an 11. With that 11, we're between 10 and 12. It's a rectangle room that's 30 by 40 feet. It's a giant, it's a big room. Really big room. So let's create that. So 30 is actually 6 square and 40 is 8. So it's going to be it's gonna be a 6 by 8. So that's 4, 5, 6. So that's 4 and that's 8. So here we got a room. So we got the room there. Now you wanna know if there are doors and other passages in that room. So before you go to the next room, you have to fill in this one. Now, to know these, here we are. Exit location, doors beyond a door, and chamber exit. What we not want right now are chamber exits. It's this table up here. Actually, this table up here. It requires us to roll a d12. A d20. So, let's roll a d20. We got a 14. Now, is it a normal chamber or a large chamber? For the sake of things, we're going to go with a normal chamber. So, what did we get? We got a 14. So, it's going to be there's going to be two exit locations. Now we know that we have two exits. We need to know where they will be in that place. So the exit location here are going to be in this D20 again. So let's roll a D20, and we got an 8. So 8 means that there's an entrance. The first entrance is on the left wall. So there would be an entrance here. For the sake of it, my entrances are going to be 10 wide, and they're going to be 5 feet. But that's my way of doing it. You can do it the way you want it to. But for me, that's how I do it. So we know there's an entrance here. Now that we know that, we need the second entrance, because remember, we had two entrances in that room, so we need another exit location. So we're gonna roll another d20, and we get 20. It's on the same wall as the entrance. So, it's gonna be here, in this. So we're gonna put it here, down below, right here. Now that we do this, we just repeat this process all over until we're satisfied with our dungeon. That's as simple as that. You may need to want the type of doors, like right here I want a door, and here as well. I want both doors here, because passages, I just don't like passages. They're cool for what they give, and sometimes gives off real cool tune, but I really dislike passages. So, here we get. So, we could actually roll on this table and have the door. And if we want, we can know if it's door or corridors. Do we want corridor or doors? Just pick here, you get the table here. And then go for the door. Now, the important part is beyond a door. What is beyond that passage, that exit point? So here we get, here we're going, and we're rolling a d20 again. So we get a 16. I'm going to reset this. We got a 16. So it's chamber. As you can see, between 9 and 18 is a chamber. These tables you can modify if you like more chances of getting a chamber than everything else. You can change these numbers. If you want more chances of stairs, go for stairs and everything. But right now is basically one chance out of about, I'd say, after 5, that it's gonna be anything else than a chamber. So there's a lot of chances that you roll chambers. So now we know it's a chamber, so knowing that it's chambers, we go back to the chambers again and roll another d20. And we roll an 8. It's a rectangle room, 20 by 30, which is 4 squares by 6 squares. Oh, it's a small room. So let's create that one. And I decided to create it here. So it's gonna be, I said it was gonna be 20 by 30, so it's gonna be 4 by 6. So let's create our 4 here. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I'm gonna leave it like that. I don't want it to have any exits. It's a single room, because we're going beyond the entry point, and I don't want to go beyond the entry point. You could if you were putting this elsewhere, but for now, this is gonna be it. So we still got 2 entry points to finish, so we're gonna take this one here. So we're going back above and go to beyond a door again, and we're going with the D20 again. So we roll a 6, and a 6 is a passage 20 feet straight ahead. I'm not liking passages, but for the sake of it, we'll do this one. It's another passages here. In that, passages will have exit points, though, because we don't want just long passages with nothing. So, as it said, it's a passage 20 feet straight ahead. So there's 4. It's 4 squares. So I'm gonna need 1, 2, 3, and 4. Here we get. Here we go. And now we want some. We want something. Usually, you can get the type of passages here if you want. There's tables for passages. So. If you want some passages, special passages, you can just get them here. And in the passages, you actually get chambers. So when they say you have a passages, you have to actually go into the passages table and do these. I'm not, as you can see, you're still the judge. But there you go. Now, for me, I want a door, so I'd be rolling on the doors and beyond doors. Because I want something here, so I'm putting in the middle here, I'm putting another door. So now from that point on, we have this one, and this one. We're left with 3. Important that you actually leave rooms for everything else then. So this is how you do it. So I'll just finish this map and come back to you with it when it's over. Here I am again with the actual finishing map. As you can see, I decided here to prolongate the passageway, because I ended up with another passage here and I just didn't want. So don't talk to me about the architecture, okay? Nobody would do 2 corridors, one aside each other, blah 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 blah. I do not care, this is random maps, and seriously, random is random. I do not care, people, I do not care for realism in that. I just want a map. So, here we go. Here I would have gone, I've gone with stairs that goes either upward or downstairs. I'm thinking right now it's going upstairs, but it's all up to you to decide. It would be a very long corridor usually, and I don't like very long corridors, so it's a corridor with a stair with stairs at the end and a door at the end here. Actually, great thing happens sometimes. This room said to me that there was 3 exits, and one of them was right here. In between, so it all fitted well. So that's one door I didn't have to know what was beyond, I already knew. Here I decided to go with stairs instead of chambers, as I said. Here we got a room, another room. Here I got a trapezoid room. I decided it was going to be a 6 side room, so maybe it's a weird tower or a weird room for rituals or the likes. Here I got another big room and another room here. This is gonna be an actual tower probably, and here we're probably going to get the kitchens and everything like that. Again, Here I had gotten that it would stop there. So usually these shouldn't have been there, and I would have ended up with nothing here. Here I decided it was alone, same here and here, and here as well. So, but it's all you to decide whatever you do. Your judgment is the best way to do these things. So now, once we get our map, what do we do next? Well, we have to actually stuff it with stuff. Get what each room is for. So this is what we're gonna go in for next. So we go down. Now we check. We remember our dungeon was a lair. So we go to lairs. So we got Death Trap here, and lair is right here. So this is our lair. So to know what each room does, we will need to roll a d20, and we'll know what each room can do. Once you get that, you can simply get in there, number your rooms, like so. And get on with it. And you can get on with it. So this is it for that. And once you're done with the what it is, so its room can be something, and it could be an armor stocked with weapons and armor, an audience chamber used to receive guests, a banquet room for important celebrators, barracks where the lair defenders are squattered, a bedroom for use by leaders, chapel where the lairs inhabit and worship their gods and everything, a cistern or well for drinking water, guard room, a storage room, could be a torture chamber, a training and exercise room, trophy room, latrine or bath. This is my favorite, seriously. Imagine right here. Imagine right here this big room being the latrine. Yeah, no, really not. Funny story, I already did a latrine. I got that in one of my adventure, and it was in a castle. There was a room dedicated to latrine, and it was kind of a big room. So I decided something was done, because somebody on the DM's forum actually showed us kind of toilets that actually are passageways. So I was laughing, and I was like, that's the moment I'm gonna use that. And so it was the entry point in the fortress, which was under siege, for the people to actually get in, and it was through the latrines. Basically, they had to get up the butt of the fortress. Up the butt. So, we got our map, we got everything we need, we got the, we know what's gonna be everything. Once that is written, only your mind can go wild. Now that we got our dungeon stock, we know every chamber, what it does, and everything that it is, we need to actually know if there is anything in that room, monster-wise, hazard, and everything that goes with it. So here we got the dungeon chamber content. So you could roll a d100. It could be an empty room with treasure, it could be an empty room, it could be a trick. Tricks are actually good. They're kind of like traps, but something else happens. Like you could have a door handle actually changing. That actually, I think that's funny. Seriously, one of the tricks that could happen is that maybe there was a lock, a magical lock on one of the doors, but by the time that everything done, the magic on it has gone wild, which means that anything can happen. So basically, it's a trick, and they call that a trick or something like that. It may have been simply a mage that actually did some trickery to actually just laugh at his guest. It could be whatever you want. And I did that actually to one of my players at one point. He really disliked it, but everyone else was laughing madly. There was an old room that was an actual vault, and my player actually opened it, looked at the door to see if it was locked. And he didn't check for magic or traps. He just checked for the door if it was locked. As soon as he grabbed the handle, he was changed to a woman. He was a man and he was changed to a woman. And then the door opened. So it's quite an easy trick. You can actually switch their alignment. You can switch their gender. You can actually erase their memory. That's a bad one. Seriously, don't do that to your players, because if you erase too much, you end up erasing the actual mission, and they don't even know what they're doing there anymore. But true story, I did that once, and it really backfired on me. It could be whatever you want. So imagine in those tables they have geese, the spell geese, on a handle. It's like the guy touches it and then boom, he's on a whole new quest out of nowhere. That's still funny. But there's one thing that came to my mind with those tricks, and that's actually somebody reading a book which gives him a suggestion. And that suggestion actually makes him open up a secret door. Imagine that. A player just finds a book out of nowhere, somewhere. He checks if it's magical and everything. He finds that yes. He opens the book and boom! Just goes blank like that. And then start going toward the wall. Hits a button on the wall. And then the door opens, and then he comes back to himself. That could be great, seriously. So, chamber content, really easy. If you want some hazards, you can have some with spiderweb, violet fungus, yellow molds, shrikers, green slime, brown molds, all things that can be done with that. You get obstacles, like reverse gravity in a room, a wall of fire blocks the passage somewhere, and everything. You get a trap effect if you ever need some traps. You got a lot of traps here. Trap trigger and the damage severity. Basically, in Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition, it works by the damage works by severity. A setback is just a few damage points you do. So usually you do that before an encounter because you want the challenge to be higher than you want. Dangerous is that you have a chance to die, but you're not sure you're gonna die. And then you have deadly, if that triggers, you're gonna die. That's how it works. Here's the trick I told you. You can, the trick object could be a book, a brain preserved in a jar. Yeah, brain in a jar. Really bad memories about that one. A brain in a jar. Burning fire, cracked gem, door, fresco, furniture, glass sculpture, a pool of water, whatever it is. And then you get the tricks that ages the first person to touch the object. The object could animate. Imagine a door handle that actually animates and tries to hit people. That could be funny as hell. Creates a force field, an illusion, changes one substance to another, such as gold to lead. If you really want to make your players really mad at you, go for that one. Seriously. Change all of their hard-earned gold into lead. Yep. That's a bad one. But if you need your players to have no more loot, that's one option. Suppression of magic item, enlarge or reduce characters, magic mouth, speaks a riddle, confusion. Geese, give direction, grants a wish, geese, as I said, induces greed. Yeah. Touch the door and I want all gold in the world. Yeah. That's gonna help. So, all of these, there's a lot of them. You actually hit the 100, with 100 being swap two or more characters' minds. lots of pleasure with that. Ask your play. If you do that, ask your players to actually exchange character sheets. They end up with each other's abilities, and add to that that they have a 50% chances that they activate the wrong ability when they actually try to do something. Imagine a druid that ends up in the fire's body. He doesn't even know how to use a sword. He's like, shit. And that fighter actually in a druid that once actually he knows he can actually wild shape. He tries but can't. Instead of wild shaping, could be using his magic slots. Things like that. If you want, you have after that the general furnishing and appointment. You can have bags, barrel, bed, benches. You can actually fill up your dungeon with these. I usually don't do that. I actually just know what kind of room it is, and then I guess what's in it by the description that I had of the room. But if you don't know what to put in it, these are great helps. You can actually use these tables to actually know what you can craft if you're in the crafting, like I do, and I do use these to craft things. Religious articles, really helpful. Stencils and personal items if you're in a bedroom, whatever. Mage furnishing, things that you can find for mages. Container content is one thing that I like. If you end up with treasure chests, or drawers, or whatever, you can actually know what's in there. Imagine opening a drawer and finding gelatin all over it. Ew. Books, scrolls, and tomes, whatever you can. And we're done with that. This is how you actually create an adventure. So, it could be it. I like the DMG because it has the monsters list. So, if you're seeking and it's by type, like Arctic monsters are all here, coastal monsters are all there, forest monsters, desert monsters. So, let's say we want a dungeon. And we know it's a... Under a chasm, so we could go with Underdark Monsters here and go for that. There's a lot of thing, and you have the their actual CR challenge rating. So that's it. So we're done. We've done everything. We got our adventure, we got our everything. The only thing that's left is for you to actually create the events that's gonna happen and the monsters that's gonna happen in these dungeons. So, but we got our map, we got the adventure location, we got the history of the dungeon, of the lair, we got the actual dungeon type, which is a lair. And we got everything we need, so at this point, we have a great adventure that's already there. As you could see, I actually had a lot of ideas by just doing this. The map itself took me about 15 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes, depending on the size of the thing. It can go wild, it can go slow. You'll see, doing it all, that's why I'm not furnishing it, I'm just rolling to see what kind of room it is. I'm not furnishing it. That's actually saving me much more time. But if you want, you can furnish it. You can do whatever you want. And the maximum it's going to take you to actually create a full adventure like that is about an hour or so. So let's calculate. It took us about 15 to 20 minutes to actually... It took us about 15 minutes to actually know what kind of adventure we wanted. It took us about 20 minutes to actually create a map, and now we're about 35 minutes in, and all we need at this point is monsters and the likes. Actually choosing monster is gonna be easy because probably they're all humans with the criminal mastermind, so that really helps us create what we need. And monsters are quite easy to figure out. There's a lot of NPCs already in the Monster Manual. And yeah, the Monster Manual, there's a lot of NPCs already done. You may need, let's say that about another 15-20 minutes for the monsters. And another, say, 15 minutes to actually get the kind of story you need there, because if you take more than 15 minutes to make a story, you're putting a lot, you're putting probably too much details in it. So don't try. My guess is don't try to beat the adventures that you can see on the that Wizard does. Those adventures were written by like 3, 4, even 5 people, and they were like brainstorming and everything. So it goes really fast when you're more than one head. So if you think you're fast enough, go for it. But here we are, and that's about sums it up. For an adventure, a one-night adventure, this is about an hour work at top. Now, I'm gonna tell this again. It's another tip that I like. It is to actually work by time. That's how I create stuff. I create it by time, not by campaign or adventure size or whatever. A lot of people say, I'm gonna create my adventure and it's gonna take the time it takes to do it. I did that before. I used to do that, and seriously, I had a lot of problems with it. Problems that ended up, we had like 4 or 5 sessions, and in the end, nobody was finishing the story because it was way too long. And campaigns would go all the way, all 25, 30 sessions. It would take a whole year for those 1 hour sessions I had back in school. So, nah, it didn't work. If I had worked that way by time, back in the days, I would have known that my sessions would have been 1 hour long maximum. And adventures would have been much more. I could have done adventures that would be like 2 sessions or 3 sessions at max, and then pass to something else. So, yeah, design by time. Know that if your sessions are 2-3 hours long, you have to actually hasten up, go forward on your tables, or slow down if you're too fast. Actually work the way you can to actually make that 2-3 hour long session worth it. So working by time, good advice. Seriously, use that. Work by time. Try to have a start at the start for your session, a middle of your session, and an end of your session, and everything's gonna be good. This was how you make a random map to go along with your adventures. Thanks for watching, and if you liked, use the like button, and if you haven't subscribed yet and would like to get new videos from me, just subscribe. Thanks for watching.